The Western pro-life movement cares about protecting young mothers and their children from harm. But historically, that's also what the law is designed to do. Will those laws be restored? Yes, they will. And we will show you how. On this edition of Life Matters, with your host, Brian Johnston, the Western Director of the National Right to Life Committee. He has served in many capacities while advocating for innocent lives, as California Commissioner on Aging, as Chairman of the California Pro-Life Council, on the board of the National Legal Center for the Medically Dependent and Disabled. And now here's our host, Brian Johnston.
Welcome back to Life Matters. We're your program on the right to life, on what it really is, on the battle of ideas that is swirling all around us. And the battle is focusing on this idea that has been handed down by America's founding fathers and magnified by them, that we as human beings have inalienable rights given from a creator. The very first one is the right to life. So both your life and your right to be alive is not given by the government. It's actually given by your God. That's what our founder said. But the government does have a duty to ensure these rights. Again, the founder said, for this reason, governments come into existence. To ensure these rights, governments are instituted among men. So America's founders outlined this very important principle, and it echoes throughout Western civilization. If you look at America's founding and reach back through the British traditions, the Magna Carta, and how the British pulled away from the divine right of kings, which basically implied that the government has the right to do what it wants, because God gave me this right, so I can do what I want now that I have the power. No, that was a misunderstanding of principles. The British refined it, and Americans inherited it and refined it even further, getting down to the bottom line as why we're alive as human beings and how to live fulfilled and free lives. We've been given a great gift. But the right to life was destroyed in 1973 by the famous Roe v. Wade and Doe v. Bolton cases. I've written a book about that. I recommend you read it. It's called Evil Twins, Roe and Doe, How the Supreme Court Unleashed Medical Killing. Very important to understand what those decisions, they are twin decisions. It's not often presented to you that way, but those are the facts. Twin decisions came down, and what they did is alter our culture and our society and our laws at their very root. But believe it or not, we're not going to talk about that book. Great book, you know. But we're not going to talk about many other aspects of this whole debate that are in the book. I'm going to talk about one thing today, and that's what we do on Life Matters, either myself or a guest. We'll take a deep dive into one aspect of this right to life issue, why you need to understand it. And today we're going to look at the Texas law that was passed in 2020 in Texas that caused great consternation and went up to the Supreme Court. At the end of the year 2021, the Supreme Court actually held two hearings. They had two hearings on state laws. And the Texas law, even after that hearing, has remained in effect. And in the laws of Texas, because that law remains on the books, there are no abortions being done in Texas to this moment. Right now I'm recording in the middle of December of 2021. There's no abortions being done. That says so much about this law, and it explains, and I hope you know, that the abortion advocacy world is very upset about the Texas law. I'm going to focus on that law, why it's significant, why the distinction, the most important distinction among other things, isn't just that it's the heartbeat law. We'll talk about that a little bit. But the real dramatic difference is that it uses civil law to respect the life of the child. Most other, in fact, all other pro-life proposals have been the use of criminal law to punish abortionists. But this is the use of civil law. So buckle your seatbelts. We're going to focus on the difference between civil law and criminal law, and in particular, why it's so powerful and why it means so much as to the value of human life, as to the rights of the individual and the duties of the individual which America's built on. It's so important to understand our founding principles, and many Americans, even good pro-life Americans, I got to tell you, even conservative Americans I've met, don't fully understand the actual principles of our founding, and they need to be cherished. I personally believe that the right to life is the very foundation of all our other freedoms. We'll talk about that another time. I've had calls and we've had emails at California Pro-Life and at Life Matters Radio. We get your emails, and recently quite a few said, hey, we don't know what you're talking about. We don't know what civil law is. We don't know what enjoin. Why are you using legal terms? And I want to tell you, I understand. I understand that you don't get it. We don't get it as a culture. Americans at large, it isn't just you. It's me too. And it's our fellow citizens. Even though we've been through school, many people are college and postgraduate students still don't understand how civics really works. And we're very poorly educated. So I'm going to spend a little time. We're going to talk again about the Texas law. If you're just joining us, the significance of the laws in Texas that are now working. This is in the year 2021. Now working to protect babies. The Supreme Court's going to rule on this law at some point. My hope is that it will come down in a joint ruling in the spring and that the Supreme Court will uphold the Mississippi law. There's been a lot more talk about the Mississippi law, which bans abortions after 15 weeks. The Texas law deals with abortions after the heart can be measured as beating 6 weeks. But the most important aspect and powerful aspect is that it isn't a government official that enforces that. It's actually normal citizens who have been harmed. And so we'll spend time talking about civil law. By the way, as a kid, when I was 16, between the year of 16 and 19, I worked for a law firm in Los Angeles, a powerful law firm. I didn't realize how significant it was until I had spent time there. I loved that experience. Our neighbors and dear friends, the Thorntons, Timothy M. Thornton was one of the partners, and he wanted me to work for this law firm. So I was an office aide and a gopher. Then I went on from there, and I would serve papers. I was always down at the courthouse to make sure those papers were filed and stamped. So I did all that stuff, all of the bureaucratic stuff. So I worked for that law firm. It was a great law firm. It turns out that they were an entertainment law firm. They had other civil law practice, but it was a very humbling experience. And I was honored to be part of this. So I've been in and around law for a long time. And then many of you know that I taught for many years and then went into working for National Right to Life back in 1985 and have worked as an advocate, a legal advocate, what's known as a lobbyist, but that's actually a form of lawyer. You may not know that, but in many parts of the world, people say, well, you're a lawyer, aren't you? And I said, well, I'm an advocate and I have a lot of experience around law. But the fact is that in many parts of the world, lawyering is divided up. There's barristers, there's solicitors, and there's advocates, and they all have a different role in law. So let me spend a little time talking to you about the details of law, because many of our listeners don't understand the huge significance of what the Texas law does. Civil law is the fact that you can sue anybody. If you know any lawyers, ask them. In the United States of America, if you want, you can be sued for anything. You can sue anybody. And that's a sad fact of the law. It's one of the reasons I did not continue on and get my bar number and go into that profession is that a lot of times in lawyering, you're dealing with other people's problems, or sometimes what's worse, you're creating problems for other people. It is an adversarial view of the law. And it's a sad way for justice to come about, but sometimes necessary. So we're going to explain the difference between the civil law and the criminal law. The criminal law is enforced by the government, and there are government prosecutors that when someone commits a crime, it's up to the government to pursue that crime. As I mentioned, most pro-life laws historically were under the criminal laws, and they were aimed at abortionists. But there's a problem with criminal law. And you're seeing it now if you're watching the news. Some prosecutors can use what's called prosecutorial discretion. That means a law has been broken, but that prosecutor has the discretion as to whether or not they're going to enforce that law. Or maybe, as often the case, and you see it on the law shows, watch any of these legal shows, you know, and there's dozens of them, not just the CSI shows, but the legal courtroom shows where they will bargain. There's some plea bargaining. Well, I could put you up on murder and then you're going to fry, but we'll reduce it. If you'll plead guilty, we'll reduce it to manslaughter. That's actually using prosecutorial discretion. Prosecutorial discretion means a lot more. In many cases, a prosecutor, that could be an attorney general statewide. The attorney general is the prosecutor for the whole state, or it could be a district attorney. They can decide, I'm not going to prosecute this law. Now, what the reasons are, they may say, I'm not going to win, or it's going to cause more problems if I try to prosecute and lose. So you will see that happen. Tragically, I've seen that happen where states have passed a pro-life law, and yet the attorney general of that state will not prosecute the abortionists. Very frustrating. That's where civil law is hugely significant. Let me give you another example. I'm going to turn this on ahead so you get it. You already know the difference. You just don't realize you know the difference. And if I mention this one name, you're going to get it, and that's O.J. Simpson. Because O.J. Simpson, he was prosecuted under the criminal law. And Johnny Cochran, as you recall, he was one of a fistful of good defense attorneys. They were able to create shadow of a doubt. You have to be able to prove in criminal law beyond a reasonable shadow of a doubt. And if there's any doubt, then, as they say, well, if it does not fit, you must acquit. Do you remember that? So if you create any doubt in a criminal case, if any juror says, well, maybe somebody else did it, you're going to lose that case, and that's precisely what happened. As you recall, that took months, O.J. Simpson's criminal trial. But immediately afterwards, there was an O.J. Simpson civil lawsuit. And in that, the Brown family, literally the parents and the family members said, you killed our sister. You have harmed us as a family. We're suing you in civil court for the harms you have created to us. That didn't even last a half hour in judgment. Guilty, because there's very different standards of judgment in civil law than in criminal law. When I come back, I'm going to explain how the media has been lying to you about the Texas law. They've been misrepresenting how terrible it is. It's going to be awful. You know they're going to say that because it's stopping abortion in Texas right now. It is estimated that 100 babies every day are saved because that law is on the books. That is hugely significant. I want you to understand why. Because our goal is to protect the innocent. That's actually the purpose of the law. That's the reason we live in society, and our founders knew that. That there are certain rights in society that government must ensure. And if it fails to ensure those rights, it's not a just government. But the power of government actually emanates from individuals. In America, we understand that principle. And what's cool about civil law is now individuals who have been harmed, and I emphasize that, and we'll explain after the break, if you've been harmed, you can go to court to seek relief. You can say, hey, something's wrong here, Your Honor. It needs to be addressed. And in civil court, if you have a case, you can win. Happens every day, and now it's being done in Texas against abortionists. We're going to talk about more of that when we come back.
Life Matters continues after this.
It's your tax-deductible year-end donations that keep us on the air throughout the year. We broadcast throughout California, and our podcasts are listened to over and over, equipping pro-life individuals in this state for the very difficult battle of ideas. It's your help that allows us to do that. Please consider donating now at californiaprolife.org. californiaprolife.org. Thank you, and God bless you.
And now back to more Life Matters with Brian Johnston.
We're back, and we were talking about the importance of the civil law in Texas. Many pro-life laws deal with criminal prosecution, and that means you have to have a prosecutor who's going to bring that against the abortionist, sometimes for political reasons. A prosecutor does not want to go after an abortionist. That's what happened in Pennsylvania, by the way. You know, in 1989, Pennsylvania had passed some very sweeping laws that they had in the books. And yet, if you look at the story of Dr. Gosnell, those in authority, the governor and the attorney general of Pennsylvania, simply looked the other way. They used prosecutorial discretion, if you will. And Gosnell was, if you've seen the movie, I recommend that movie, Gosnell. And it's a very well-directed movie, well-produced, and you'll learn a lot about abortion and abortion law. But prosecutorial discretion allowed that evil to continue. That's criminal law. We talked about that. Civil law is what happens every day. And in California and across the nation, there are civil lawsuits filed every day. Many of them are, in fact, frivolous lawsuits. That's when somebody sues you just to get after you, or they want to shake you down. That's known as a frivolous lawsuit without merit. Now, the media, when it talks about the Texas law on abortion, the first thing they say is, this is going to cause all sorts of problems. Anybody can sue now. Let me remind you, anybody can sue now, right now, under the civil law, on just about everything, but not abortion. What the Texas law says is if you have standing and have been harmed, just as in the O.J. Simpson case, that family could sue. You couldn't. You could have tried in civil court to sue O.J. I would predict if you had done that, the judge would say, you have not suffered harm. Yeah, but I think he was guilty. You could be irate, but then it would be a frivolous lawsuit because you have not suffered any harm. The Brown family did. They suffered a very real harm, demonstrable. And if your child is killed, for example, a father, right now, let me remind you in the United States, this is all about a woman's right to choose, we're told. That's the incantation. But the father of the child has no rights. And that has happened in many cases where often in a case where there's a fight, if there's a breakup, where there's a divorce, that the woman will use that opportunity to punish her former spouse, or even not former. He can be the existing father of that child, and she'll go and have that baby killed. Now, in Texas, if that happens, that father has the right and the ability to say, my child was killed, and that child was wanted. And we had talked about keeping the child, and yet she was talked into an abortion, maybe by friends, maybe there was some other issue, but clearly by the abortionist, because that's what he does. All the abortionist does is kill human babies. That's their profession. So he or she is a killer. And he or she, just like OJ, needs to be held accountable somehow. And those withstanding, is to say, those who have been harmed, may now seek relief. They may get justice in Texas. This is huge. So it's not only fathers, by the way. Think of other folks. There's also grandparents. And that's to say, if you have a minor daughter, as is often the case, it was the case and still is the case in California, secret abortions done on a minor child without the parents ever knowing. And yet the parents would love to have known. They would have loved to care for their daughter and her child. That's their grandchild. They, I predict, would have standing because they have been immediately harmed, and that's demonstrable. The media and the pro-abortion media and most of the coverage of this have said, oh, this is scandalous. This means that anyone can go legacy hunting. They can know there was an abortion. If they're in front of these kooky pro-lifers with signs are in front of abortion clinics, and they'll see a car drop a girl off. It's an Uber driver dropping the girl off, and they get the license plate, and they're going to sue that Uber driver. This is terrible. I'm sorry. The way real civil law works is that right now you can be sued for anything, but the real issue is standing. And I assure you that if that Uber driver, unbeknownst and without any malice, is dropping someone off, somebody with an abortion sign, an anti-abortion sign, has no standing to sue that individual because they have not suffered a harm. And if they'd like to assert that they have, they're going to have a hard time because they're going to have to go before the local trial judge. Standing in civil cases is the very first question. Okay, we're going to have a lawsuit here, but why do you get to sue? Tell me your story. Why are you the person that gets to sue them? And standing is established at the local court level. So the media has been lying about what would happen. because everything in civil law is already confusing. And anybody can sue. And literally, Justice Alito, who is an unsung hero, by the way, at the Supreme Court, he brought this up and he shut them down. They don't want to hear it. But Justice Alito said, I'm sorry, but last time I checked, the courts are already backlogged. There literally are a billion cases. He didn't say million, he said billion, brought throughout the United States to civil courts. And the vast majority of them are ruled out because of standing. And he knows how the civil law really works. They're using that phenomenon, an existing phenomenon in law of the advocacy system where there is a conflict. You can use the law for conflict, but if you don't have standing, you can't. So don't believe that argument that somehow people who are not related at all to that abortion can go around and sue. That is a lie, and it's intellectually dishonest. We'll talk about that and more when we come back.
Life Matters continues after this.
Hi, I'm Kevin Sorbo, and I was very excited when I heard about LifeFest Film Festival. LifeFest is the film festival dedicated to showcasing films that affirm the intrinsic worth of innocent human life and the profound significance of each life. One seemingly insignificant person can in fact change the whole world in which he or she lives. That one singular life ends up being of vital importance. I'm so glad to hear that you are cherishing that in this film festival and are committed to artfully and creatively protect the lives of those who can't possibly promote themselves.
Life Film Fest is dedicated to bring the message of life to Hollywood and to our culture. Go to lifefilmfest.com and get your tickets now. That's lifefilmfest.com.
Find out about the exciting cultural change impacting Hollywood. Go to lifefilmfest.com. And now back to more Life Matters with Brian Johnston.
I do want to touch on one other aspect because we want to understand this Texas law. It is the heartbeat law. Now, if you actually have studied science, you know that the human heart starts beating very early on. In fact, many people have found and can find that heartbeat, if you know what to look for, 3 weeks after conception. But that isn't what the law says. The law says 6 weeks, that if the abortionist who's about to make some money and do what they're there to do, kill a human baby, if they see that her pregnancy is 6 weeks along, they've got to check for the heartbeat. And I have to tell you, if you are a real medical doctor, you're going to be able to find that heartbeat after 6 weeks because it's been measured after three. So what we have and what you hear our opponents say is, yeah, but it's 6 weeks. You know, the fact is that maybe, and this was Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez that said this, I might not even know I'm pregnant. Well, let me say something because she's implying a deeper statement there. And that is the idea that it's possible to not know you're pregnant. I agree. But are we implying that she's divinely pregnant? Are we implying now that pregnancy is a magical thing that people don't know anything about? No, what she's actually saying is, I'm using this for backup birth control because she's not asserting rape. She's saying, I'm pregnant and I didn't want to be, but she's not saying that this was, she's not asserting this is a magical pregnancy. She's asserting she wants to use abortion as a form of backup birth control. And every poll that you see across the nation, when they ask, and we'll talk about polling another time, I've had previous programs, the truth about abortion opinion in the U.S. and about abortion polls, but consistently, Americans do not support abortion used for birth control. That's what Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez was saying. I want to use abortion for birth control. Because when she says, I didn't know I was pregnant, oh, well, wait a second. Is pregnancy magical that you don't know what happened? Or were you raped mysteriously and didn't know this? What she is asserting is that she's using abortion as backup birth control. This is not how Americans view abortion. That is not what they're comfortable with. And yet that's what the abortion advocates have always been asserting. They want abortion as a form of birth control. They want to be able to dispose of that baby just because they don't want it. That's what choice is. You don't need to have a reason. It's based on whether you want that baby or not. It's my personal choice. I don't care about the age. I don't care about any other factors. I choose to be unpregnant. Very important distinction there. So this Texas law, as we are recording now at the end of the year 2021, it's still in effect. It is causing great consternation. You'll note that the media doesn't talk about it that much because when people understand it better, they actually favor it. And even what limited knowledge Americans have about it, they don't mind the Texas law. This is hugely significant. And I hope that we get to the point it's going to be tougher in California. I told you at the beginning I was going to give you things that you can still do. Here in California, even if Roe is overturned, we're not going to be able to stop abortion in California. All that Roe is going to do, the overturn of Roe, it's going to allow states to protect babies in their borders, in their jurisdictions, and 21 states are going to do that immediately when Roe's overturned. Many others are going to have to pass laws. Here in California, our governor will not allow any of that. He believes in unlimited abortion. He believes in choice as I just explained it. Choice is not for hard cases. Don't believe that myth. Again, we've talked about myths. Don't have time in this program. But the fact is they want abortion on demand at any time, for any reason, and for free, paid for by your tax dollars. If you're going to change that, you have to work at the local level, believe it or not. And not just with counseling centers. There are hundreds of counseling centers in California. But that isn't what's going to end this. We need the law. The law is what has always protected life. The law is the reason that life was protected before 73. And you might say, yeah, but I don't want to get involved in politics. But this has always been about voting and politics. And even on the high court, as they wait for a decision, each of those justices has to vote. So this has always been about voting. And on your local level, there are school boards that are bringing in Planned Parenthood. The only way to stop that is to know who is going to be on your school board. Would you like to help us do that? California Pro-Life Council needs people in every community willing to help to poll those candidates so that you know what their position is before they're elected. It's good work, but it's hard work. To find out more, go to californiaprolife.org and look to volunteer, and there you can find out how to help locally in your community. We're rolling out statewide. We need this done in every town, village, and hamlet. That's how we're going to take California back. Keeping Planned Parenthood in check. Electing people, not just at the highest level. Yes, we want a good governor. Yes, we want good assembly, senate. We want good members of Congress. But the way you get them is making sure you've got a good city council. You've got a good school board. The only way to do that is to understand civics, to be involved, and to make sure that your vote is a vote for life. Thank you.
Life Matters is a production of the California Pro-Life Council, the state affiliate of National Right to Life.